Hello, I'm Maha at Maha's Musings. Thank you for joining me today. I'll be book reviewing Haruki Murakami's Hard-Boiled Wonderland and the End of the World, which he wrote in 1985 and for which he won a Tanizaki Prize for it. His work has been translated by Alfred Birnbaum. Let me start with a quote from the story. The passing of autumn leaves a temporary blank, an empty hole in the year that is not of a season at all. This is a very apt quote from the book because Murakami's stories are not of one season either. They fill different genres. This book is part sci-fi, thriller, fantasy, philosophy, mystery, and folk tales, all seamlessly put together in one story. The story is basically split into two realms, and also the chapters are organized as such that the first part of the story is chapter 1, 3, 5, 7, and the second part of the story is chapter 2, 4, 6, 8, and so forth. It all works together because Murakami manages to heighten your sense of curiosity and wonder and the tempo of the story as you're reading it. So in the first part of the story, the protagonist is nameless and he is based in Tokyo and he is working for the government, the system, as a number cruncher, as a calcutech, who's basically a data processor who encrypts codes. And his mind, his consciousness has been taken over by an eccentric scientist, an eccentric old man scientist who used to work for the system, but no longer. And this is what the protagonist has to say. My consciousness is borrowed and something is processed while I'm unaware. So, you know, the old scientist really reminds me of that elderly man character from Squid Games, who's like the brains behind the story. And yet he's always like has this inner joke where he's always going, ho, ho, ho. This is how the scientist in this book also acts out. It's interesting that this book was written in 1985, so there was no Squid Games then. The second part of the story has to do with a very different world. It's ethereal, it's mysterious, and the protagonist here doesn't know how he entered this world. But when he does, he finds out that the characters don't have a mind and they don't have shadows. And he is given the task of being a dream reader of unicorn skulls. So the two worlds, the two realms do overlap with each other because Murakami uses certain words that exist in both these realms. Words like skull, library, librarian, memories, end of the world. So you do know, you do see a connection as you're reading along, but you do wonder when are these worlds going to collide with one another? And when they do, is it going to be through a portal or how? So he leaves you wondering in that respect. There's a lot of prose to this story, you know, a lot of interesting things that I came across. One of them has to do with the fact that Murakami's writing always makes you think about the larger picture. And for example, the role of identity in one's life. How important is it? And what does it mean? And how do you see it, you know? And does it make you happy if you know what your identity is? In this story, you do see the loss of identity affecting the protagonist, you know? So that's something to think about, you know, the loss of identity. He also introduces the characters in such a way that they don't have any names. They are introduced to us by their profession. For example, the colonel, the librarian, the caretaker, the gatekeeper, the scientist. So we get to know them in a way where the barriers are down and we're allowed to see ourselves in the characters. I like how Murakami chooses to allow you to see yourself in the characters that are not named in the story. Another aspect of Murakami, which I really enjoyed and came across in this book, is that he has a really sharp and witty sense of humor. You know, I don't really see that being highlighted when one sort of talks about Murakami. We talk about his refined writing and magical realism, but what about being funny? And that really came across in this book. I wasn't prepared to be pate for some creature from the Black Lagoon. I wanted to die under the sun. And this is the protagonist thinking aloud about the end of his life. Like, he finds himself in a very strange Kafkaesque situation, and this thought comes to him, and it made me laugh out loud. And I was really sort of taken by surprise, this element of surprise in Murakami's book, which I really enjoyed. I also enjoy tropes like, you know, he talks about music, which he tends to do in his other books, Western music, classical music, references to pop culture, to Bob Dylan, music. It's like he's addressing a younger audience. You know, he's sending a message to them that, you know, you might find this book pretty interesting because it has all these other elements to it as well. Now, there are also some cons to the book. You know, although I'm a big admirer of Murakami, I can see where, you know, certain things didn't really sort of appeal to me in the book. And one of them had to do with the fact that, you know, he tends to use a lot of scientific jargon in the story. And that's when the story dipped for me, because I wasn't too familiar with that. But then, having said that, I also learned some new words like Calcutech as I read along, and I realized part of the bigger picture, if you will, to sort of go through that, you know, in the story. One other thing which I wasn't too keen on was the way he portrays female characters. They're kind of objectified as the chubby girl, the fat girl, the women who have very large appetites and really love to eat their food, and they really sort of, you know, ate everything, and they really love their food, and so he's perplexed by that. There's no need to objectify women in this respect, not in this day and age. Although I do understand the cultural lens that he's coming from, because Japan tends to be still a very pretty traditional society, and women's place or attitude towards women in it. Now, the ending of the story was a bit of a con, a bit of a disappointment for me. I wish the story had ended in a different way, but I'm not going to tell you what that was. I wonder if Murakami, if he'd had the choice in which the protagonist saw himself, would he have chosen differently, or was he putting himself in the protagonist's place? I don't know. I would love to ask him this question. So I really think that, you know, all in all, this is a very, very fascinating read. It's very bizarre, but it's not difficult to read for most of the part. And I love the tempo of the story. There is a lot of action going on, and it makes you introspect about the larger picture, about mortality, immortality. I mean, would you rather have a perfect immortality or an imperfect, finite world? Is Murakami trying to say that immortality could be more hellish than mortality? That's for you to decide. He leaves these questions unanswered. And that's the beautiful thing about Murakami. He gives you the freedom to choose and to interpret how he sees his story unfolding. I would give this book a 4 stars out of 5, because it's just a very compelling read, very unique. And thank you so much for joining me today. If you haven't subscribed to my channel, please do so. I'd love to hear your comments or any suggestions you may have on what I have to say and on my book reviews. And I look forward to seeing you soon again. In the meanwhile, take care. And you can also find me on Instagram and on Goodreads as well. Have a good weekend. Bye for now.